I think it's time to do another teardown, and I found something in the bin at work that might just be interesting to do. It is a power supply from a rack-mounted set of ancient Gandalf modems. You may have seen this thing briefly when I was tearing down a different Gandalf modem a month or two back. I just showed this as a demonstration of how a rack-mounted set of them that are in a card cage would get their power from something like this guy. Just as a refresher, Gandalf was a Canadian manufacturer, started back in the 70s and ran out of good ideas and money back here in the 90s, and then Mitel bought out what was left of them a handful of years later. There's a Wikipedia article if you care about obscure Canadian tech companies from decades ago. But anyway, I have this thing, which is a power converter, DC converter. It takes -48 volts in, so the ground or common is the negative, or is the positive, sorry, and the hot is negative, which is backwards to most things that most industry use. Telecom is pretty much exclusively the users of -48 volt power, and it throws a lot of people off. I actually just tripped on it there, and I've been working with this stuff for over 20 years. Anyway, so it takes 48 volts in and puts out a split 12 volt power supply. So you have plus 12 volts above ground and negative 12 volts below ground, or below common. And that would go to feed, like I said, a rack of modem modules, which were just as petite as this thing is. So, what can we see from the back? It's got a 5 amp fuse, negative voltage, positive voltage, and ground. And internally, they're all separate. The ground is connected to the chassis, plus and minus are floating. But in the system, the positive voltage would be ground referenced. 5 amp, 250 volt slow blow fuse. That's reasonable. And deep inside there, we can see a couple of boards that have what you'd expect on a power supply, a whole thumping load of capacitors and various other things. We'll dig into there in a bit. On the back here, let's just, before we start tearing into it, look at what's visible. There's a couple of monster diodes, presumably in series with the output, because the output's going to go along this edge connector into the card cage and carry on to the rest of the modules. So I'm guessing that those two are just protection and steering the voltage to make sure that nothing goofy comes backwards into this. They are G1751, which are 100 volt 6 amp diode with 0.9 of a volt forward drop. So 6 amps should be more than adequate for passing all the current out. The other notable thing back here is an LM339, which is a quad comparator. And initially, let me just zoom that back out a little bit. Initially, I guessed that that would be for alarming this thing, for sending alarms out of it. But I spent some time tracing it off camera, and actually, let's flip it over here. These two pins on the edge connector connect to two inputs, that one there and that one there. This one's coming in via a resistor, and this one's coming straight in and then going to a resistor. Those resistors are pull-ups, I believe I checked them as. And So it would seem that these being connected to inputs and then the two outputs of the quad comparators, only two sections of the comparator are being used, by the way. That's what all the blank pins are about. The other two sections aren't used. Any of those are inputs, and the other input that it's comparing against is also tied through a resistor to a bus. So that basically an input signal on there, either a high or a low, is going to toggle this guy and set the two output pins, pin 1 and 14. It's going to set them either low or high, and those go through these skinny little traces over to those two wires there, which are these two here, and they go inside, which I'm assuming are going to be coming from some of the other modules in the card cage and sending an alarm signal back here, which probably will shut down the modules inside. But anyway, that's about all we can see from outside, and that's about all the research I've done too. So let's get in her. So there's a couple of screws on the back here. I'm gonna guess that's what's holding this black lid on that I'm hanging out here. Okay, and that pops up and not going anywhere. What's up in? Is he in there? No. Oh, I wonder if this handle on the front, the screws for that handle are holding it together. Aha! There we go. We're in. All right, so there's those couple of modules that I could see inside there. So I'm guessing one is providing a positive 12 volt. They're creating positive 12 volts. The other one's creating a negative 12 volts out of that incoming 48. They look to be identical. BAS09 by Absopulse. Oh, okay. They're both BAS09. Absopulse is another Canadian company. I'll have to go and look them up quickly, but they actually still exist, I believe. They, if I remember correctly, make basically voltage converter blocks that they don't sell to end users, they sell to other companies for doing exactly stuff like this. Anyway, so let's take a look, see what we've got here, since they're both the same. Here's our power coming in from the terminal strip on the back through the fuse. So that's that and that. That makes it the ins, which makes these other guys here the outs. And there we see them showing up back over there in the back corner. Those two from this one and these two from this one. Okay. Yeah, while we're here, let's take a look at these two signal wires. The signal wires don't go into the modules. They just go to the front panel. Okay. So E6 and 7 are a pair of black wires. It's all black and white up at the front here. But those two are going to be showing the output voltage present. So these two are alarms, MD1 and MD2. I don't know what that means, but I'm guessing that's what those two inputs are. So they're not shutdowns. They're just alarms from the rest of the shelf. That's interesting. Okay. Now let's pop one of these modules up. Like I said, they're both the same part number, which means that they're just both generating 12 volts, and one has its wires plus and minus coming off, and the other one will be minus and plus. And the positive of one and the negative of the other will be tied together. So it is putting them together as a common ground, and then you have 12 volts above that ground and 12 volts below that ground, like we were discussing when we were looking at the front of it. Okay, we'll play with that later. And actually, I'll see if I can maybe find something around here that I can give it enough voltage on the input to actually create that 12 volt output. So now then, why doesn't that want to lift? Oh, there's a big heatsink block here with, looks like some transistors or something screwed onto it. So I guess that'll be these screws on the back here. There we go. Okay. So now she'll just flip up and over. Okay. What do we have here? I think actually I'm going to pull these wires off so I can get it in the middle of the board. Yeah, those are formed well enough. Those shouldn't have any trouble figuring out where those go back on. So, what do we have here? That's a little too zoomy. Okay, so that was the two power inputs. See them? Yeah, there it's marked plus there, so that's got to be the minus. So that goes over towards there. So you got a couple of capacitors and parallel across them. This is in series with one side of it, and this is in series with the other. Okay. So, wow. So, I don't know if you can see that down in there. This in the back here looks like just a little piece of wire with one loop in it. It's either a super lightweight inductor or it's a fusible link. And I'm going to guess it's probably a fusible link. Now, this guy here, the shape of it looks like an MOV, but it doesn't have any markings on it, and an MOV wouldn't make sense. What else could it be? Wouldn't be a capacitor because this is DC coming in. Might be, that would be a weird shaped resistor though. I don't think that's what it is. Onward and upward. Goes in through there, then we got this big honking diode. Back in frame here, thank you. So after that, it goes through this big honking diode. Negative is to that side. That's the positive, negative. So it's, well, the diode's reverse biased. Okay, so that's protection. And yeah, that's in parallel again. Okay, so that's input protection. Another capacitor, another two capacitors, a big one for low frequency filtering and a small one for higher frequency, smaller value for higher frequency filtering, again in parallel, and then a pair of inductors in series, and then more capacitors. So they do not want this thing to create any noise going back towards the power system in the central office that this thing's probably installed in. So that, and they also don't want any interference coming back in here either, I'm guessing. So that is a whack of filtering on the input side there. Man, they don't want that thing to get hurt. Okay, so from there it goes into a couple of windings of this transformer here. The transformer is actually labeled Absolpulse. Wow. Either custom made for them, or do I dare dream that they actually custom wound their own transformers in-house? That would be amazing. Anyway, so these, now it gets a little convoluted. But it's going to essentially be a switch mode power supply, right? I mean, that's what it's got to be. So this little daughter board on here, which is on a row of pins down there, down to the main board. And there's a second little daughter board here, which is, where are we? It is right along here. So that's going to be your controls, and I can see a chip in there. Let me just see if I can get in there with my magnifying glass and actually figure out what it is, though. Okay, so that chip in there is, in fact, an SG3524N, which is a regulating pulse width modulator. The data sheet says they can also be used as the control element in high power output applications. Designed for switching regulators of either polarity, transformer coupled DC to DC converters, transformerless voltage doublers, and polarity converter applications in employing fixed frequency pulse width modulation techniques. That just told us an awful lot about this circuit right here. So somewhere down in there, there's going to be that fixed frequency oscillator that they talked about. And this thing is controlling pulse width modulation, which will be controlling these, at least two of these transistors over here. Now, what kind of transistors those are, that's going to take a little bit more digging. So this board here, which I'm not going to reverse engineer because that would, it's got tiny traces and it would entail me ripping it out of here and destroying the thing, which I don't feel like doing. So let's just take it as read that these two control boards here with this PWM chip are in charge of switching these guys. So their switched output is going to, or they're going to be switching the input voltage through this transformer, which will be stepping that PWM signal down based on, and by how much it steps it down will be based partially on the pulse width that it's getting on the input here, right? Just like any normal modern switch power supply. So then we've got a whole stack of capacitors and inductors on this side, which I'm going to switch back to this side again. So here is the secondary side of the transformer. There's no isolation slot, but there's a big old gap there. So we've got pretty good protection, primary to secondary, on that. Not that it matters, because this isn't line voltage anyways. This is 48 volt input, remember. But still, massive separation there. So our outputs are coming off here, and these pairs of tracks, that is an electrolytic capacitor, that is an electrolytic capacitor, that's one. Series inductor, parallel capacitor. As we can see there, electrolytic capacitors, series inductors, electrolytic capacitors. And then over here, right at the output, here is our plus and minus 12 volts. I'm not, let's see, no, this will be minus up here because the minus side of the capacitor is up on that side. And then some higher frequency capacitors just across them to get rid of any excess high frequencies, like really high frequencies that these guys won't respond to. Not quite sure what those are. Are those just 0-ohm resistors acting to parallel these two buses? Possibly. So this could actually be a... Actually, yeah, the way it's laid out, it looks like it could have been a dual rail power supply, with one rail being there, one rail being there, and two more output connectors, but they've bussed them together. Now, I don't know whether those would have to be in the same polarity, otherwise they couldn't get away with this shenanigans, right? But, so it could probably, without those, become 2 times 12 volts at 2 amps, but they've paralleled them up. That's kind of neat. What else is going on back here? There's a little thermal sensor on the heat sink. I wonder, can I see the part numbers on those? No, I can't. Not without completely taking them apart. Not critically important at all. They're either going to be Oh, they're probably MOSFETs, even though MOSFETs back in the day were horrendously expensive and weren't that popular to use because they were expensive. Or these could be BJTs. I'm not 100% certain without unbolting everything and undoing the heatsink goo and everything else, which I don't want to do it. So there's what that module is. I'm just going to pause for a bit and I'm going to put the whole thing back together and then I'll see if I can find some voltage around here and see if this beast powers up. Okay, I'm back from reassembling that, mostly anyway, and I have found a way that I think is going to work to power this thing with a slight bit of scariness. The sensitive among you may want to look away. So I've got a couple of these little power receptacles wired in series, positive to negative, and then the other positive or negative out to here. And I've got a pair of laptop adapters, each of which puts out 19 volt. Oh, this one's 19 volts, this one's 16 volts, at 4.5 or more amps. So 19 plus 16 in series, no, say 20 plus 15 in series, 35, 36, yeah, 35-ish volts. This thing wants 48. I don't know. We'll see. So I guess a meter would be in order. Get that out of the way. Set that on 200 volts and plug that in and plug that in. Okay, no smoke, no kaboomies yet. That's a good thing. What do we got here? 35.4, just kind of like we thought. Okay, so what's going on up front here? Oh ho! We have valid 12 volts. Awesome. So, I guess we can check. Yes, oops. So this is the 48 volt in, which is 35, yeah. And then this is 12.1 volts out, just like it says on the box. 35.3. 12.1. Cool. So then going over to here, there's these two heavier wires coming from one of the modules that we saw earlier. Oh, that's 24 volts across that. So that's the two of them in series. That's, man. There it is. So that's the two of them in series right there with 24 volts. So that means that this wire is coming from one and this one's coming from the other one. So that means that between these two over here, it's probably zero, and between there and there, okay, there's 12, and between there and there is the other 12. Okay, cool, it's working. And then, as I'd guessed earlier, these two diodes are two output protection diodes, and yeah, there's that same 24. Again, that's across the two positives, right? Let me flip this around. Across two positives, so the ground is in between them. So if I put my positive on there and my negative on one of these negatives, okay, so this is the positive of this power supply over here, and this is the negative of this power supply. Right. And then ground is in between them. Remember, I said it's a dual rail power supply. So I'm going to do a little bit more poking around back here. Okay, so poking and prodding has commenced. This one seems to be the common. And then the two outputs are there for the positive and there for the negative. Note that those are lower than what we saw back here. That's 12.1 exactly. That's 12.1. But that's 11.6. That's these diode voltage drops in series there. Okay, that's neat. And then what is this one? It's going back in here through a via, and it's underneath that aluminum, and I can't see where it's going. But anyway, that's a big heavy trace. I wonder if that's the chassis ground. So, oh yeah, the chassis ground is also isolated from the negative in here. So these two power supplies are completely isolated from the chassis. But yes, that's what that is. That's chassis ground there. Okay. So that just picks it up. There's also a ground pin. Remember, we saw there's a ground screw terminal back there. To ground this to the system, then that provides chassis ground across to the other components. Just as a protective ground, it's not part of the electrical. Okay, so I've disconnected my scary-o-matic power supply there. I'll just pull that off. Meanwhile, while I was paused there for a second, I did a bit more looking up and Googling. So Gandalf was created in 1971 and existed until the 1990s when they ceased operation. Meanwhile, Absopulse was founded in Ottawa, Ontario in 1982 and still exists to this day, making DC to DC converters mostly and power supply modules, well, as I suggested earlier, like these that are integrated into other products. They do a lot of telecom, according to their website. They also do a lot for railroads, for railway signaling and train detection, that kind of stuff. Full-size railroads, not this size railroad back there. No, full-size railroads. So that's a big niche business to be in. That's cool. And a Canadian success story, a company that still exists after all these decades. So, since Absopulse started in 1982, this has to be newer than that, and since Gandalf went tits up in 1990, or somewhere in the 1990s, that gives us a range for this thing. Mid-80s to 1990s. And that's about all I could find about it, actually. Surprisingly, there's not a lot of information about small niche Canadian electronics manufacturers on the web, especially ones that don't exist anymore. However, I hope you found this interesting. I certainly found it interesting exploring this thing, both from an electronics point of view and from a Canadiana point of view. Thanks for watching. Thumbs up if you actually liked it. Comment down below whether you liked it or didn't like it. And I will talk to you later.